forthcoming London-Melbourne air race is beginning to loom big in the public imagination, and the wife of the Agent General for Victoria names the first new plane to be especially built for the contest.
I claim this bird to have.
The pilots of this new de Havilland Comet are Mr. C.W.A. Scott and Mr. T. Campbell Black. Mr. Scott is, of course, the former record holder for the route.
Because our job is to get there first, and we think that we have the right type of machine for this particular race. Obviously, the race must be set about by a good team and a good machine. And I'm very, very glad to have Tom Campbell Black with me as co-pilot on this race, starting in 3 weeks' time.
Atlantic liners continue to arrive bearing entrance for the great air race. This is Miss Jacqueline Cochrane's Northrop plane being lowered onto a lighter from the Olympic. It is followed by the smallest machine in the race, a Lambert monocoupe named Baby Ruth. The two planes come ashore at Hamble, and although Miss Cochrane is not with her aeroplane, the pilots of the tiny monocoupe, Mrs. Wright and Philando, have a good-natured word for the camera.
Well, Johnny, here you and Baby Ruth and myself are over here. I hope we can show them something in the way of speed after this wonderful reception they've given us.
Well, we're going to do our best, Jack.
The three Comets, specially built for the great air race to Melbourne, are on their way to Mildenhall, Suffolk, for the line-up preliminary to the start on the 20th. The first Comet to arrive is being flown by O. Cathcart Jones and K.F.H. Waller. The second by C.W.A. Scott, a former record holder for the route, and T. Campbell Black. The third by Jim and Amy Morrison, both with countless aviation feats to their credit and providing a formidable combination. Other prominent competitors are, flying a Clem Eagle, Flight Lieutenant Shaw.
I wish everybody the best of luck.
The Americans Wright and Polander with Baby Ruth, their monocoupe machine. A 33F is being flown by Flying Officer Davis and Lieutenant Commander Hill. Youngest Melrose is piloting his Puss Moth, in which he recently broke the record from Australia. Squadron Leader Stollett and K.G. Stollett are flying an Airspeed Courier.
Arrived here, and we're all ready for
and the Airspeed AS-8 will be raced by Captain Neville Stack and Mr. Turner. On the eve of the start of the great race to Melbourne, the Prince of Wales arrives in his plane at Mildenhall and walks round the aerodrome, meeting, among other competitors, Mr. C.W.A. Scott. The Prince leaving one of the Dutch machines. The King and Queen also visit Mildenhall to see the closing phase of the preparations for the race. In the grey light of dawn, all is set for the start at 6:30. Jim and Amy Morrison, flying their comet Black Magic, are the first to leave. The flag drops. They're off. The race has started. The remainder take off at 45 second intervals. Cathcart Jones and Waller in another comet. The Dutch Panda, flown by Asjet and Geisendorfer, next. Another Dutch entry, Parmentier and Mull, in the KLM Douglas. Miss Jacqueline Cochrane in her Granville monoplane. Fairy Fox, flown by Parra and Hemsworth. The Miles Falcon is piloted by Brooke, who is taking a lady passenger. Melrose, who recently broke the record from Australia, is using the same Puzma. Captain Stack and his Airspeed Viceroy. finally, the Storrett brothers in an airspeed courier. Passing the finishing line at Flemington Racecourse at 200 miles an hour, the Melbourne Air Race winners land at Laverton. They are escorted back to Flemington for their welcome by Sir Macpherson Robertson, sponsor of the race. MovieTone presents the only sound film record of the replies by Scott and Black.
It's appropriate that at Melbourne, now celebrating a great achievement over its first 100 years, you have achieved such a remarkable triumph for aviation, should be receiving the first of the plaudits that you have so nobly merited from the whole civilized world.
A very short time ago, I was sitting in the cockpit of an aeroplane flying towards an almost mythical place called Melbourne. It had seemed to us that we started about 5 centuries ago, and that Melbourne, as soon as we caught up 1 mile, receded 2. So that made our journey very much longer than we had previously supposed. Particularly as it seemed remarkable that only 2 hours ago one was in such a mental state, and now one's in a very different mental state, terribly embarrassed by your enthusiasm, and yet very gracious to you indeed for being so kind and welcoming us here this afternoon. Actually, true, I wouldn't know that I was here, only somebody gave me a paper and I see that my name is in it. And, of course, as we all know, the press never lies. So, I don't think I'd better say any more, because I've been talking too much to Campbell Black the last 3 days. I've got quite husky. I've been roaring at him. He hasn't been roaring quite so much, so I'm going to get him to talk.
Ladies and gentlemen, I've never made a speech in my life, and even if I had one to make now, I'm so overwhelmed with the reception we've got that I could only say thank you.
MovieTone has already shown Scott and Black winning the air race. Here are the runners-up landing 10.5 hours later. The Dutchman, Marl, and Parmentier, who said a word about the flight.
We had a very good trip all the way, except the last night, when we were, pinched by thunderstorms and couldn't reach Melbourne. But anyhow, we arrived here a little later.
Third in the race come the Americans, Roscoe Turner and Clyde Pangborn, and their wireless operator. They, too, face the microphone on arrival. They are tired but cheerful.
A great flight, and I'll let Mr. Pangborn and Mr. Nichols speak for themselves of what they think about it, but I don't want to make another one right away. I thank you.
Here and there, we got a glass of beer.
Did you shave?
Yes, I shaved.
It's been a long trip, very tiresome. I'm glad it's over. I don't think I'd like to make another one right away.
And now Melbourne accords the heroes of the air race a triumphal procession through the city. 100,000 people are in the streets to cheer the aviators whose feats have thrilled the world. First, the winners, Scott and Black. A fair admirer breaks through and shakes Scotty by the hand. Parmentier and Mull also get an enthusiastic reception from the crowd. Then the Americans, Turner and Pangborn, to whom the scene must be reminiscent of New York. McGregor and Walker, the New Zealanders. Last comes Melrose, the young Australian. His mother can just be seen, but the police on the car prevent a view of the aviator himself. A wonderful day for Melbourne, founded only 100 years ago.